They sentenced me to 20 years of boredom.
For 20 years I've listened to Leonard Cohen, but less and less. He's not a fashionable figure. His reputation is that of a misery monger, the growling beast of the bedsits, the most morose of the 60s singer-songwriters.
Leonard Cohen.
It's a personal call.
On the wire.
He's meant to be at the hotel.
Like a drunk in a
he's staying
midnight choir. Now so long.
But I think that first in his poetry and novels, and then in his songs, he's shown a rare talent for describing desire and charting the changing emotional climate of our times.
Departed or gone,
I remember you well in the Chelsea Hotel. I came so far
for beauty.
Suzanne.
Hello, Leonard Cohen.
Jarvis. Jarvis, you sound so close. I am your man. Wise men say only fools rush in. I can't make that low note, but I can't help falling in love with you. Shall I stay? Would it be a sin? Okay.
Your voice seems to have got deeper, listening to some of the earlier albums.
Yeah, it's gotten deeper. It's about 100,000 cigarettes deeper. I think what does it is, I read in the International Herald Tribune, which is the ultimate source of all my information, that as you grow older, the brain cells connected with anxiety begin to die. You start feeling a lot better. It has nothing to do with virtue or meditation or any kind of spiritual achievement. You just start feeling better and you relax, and of course your voice gets deeper.
What made you think that you could sing?
Let's sing another song, boys. This one.
Anybody got a cigarette I could borrow?
Old and bitter.
I never thought I could sing. I didn't think singing had anything to do with it. I remember at the first large, thanks a lot. I remember the first large gathering I ever sang in front of. That was the Newport Folk Festival. I guess it must have been 67. And I remember saying to my lawyer who accompanied me there, in a state of panic, I said, I don't know what I'm doing here. I can't sing. And he said, none of you guys can sing. When I want to hear singers, I go to the Metropolitan Opera. And I think that's more or less the position I had anyways. I never thought we were singers. I certainly never had any musical standard to tyrannize me. I thought that it was something to do with the truth, that if you told your story, that's what... the song was about.
This is the first record that Leonard Cohen appeared on, a selection of Canadian poets from the mid-60s. The sleeve notes say this: Mr. Cohen, whose extraordinary lyrical gift has always driven him towards music, has recently been writing songs for the rock group The Stormy Clovers. So, before we knew him as a songwriter, Leonard Cohen was big as a poet in Canada.
There were a group of us in Montreal who... whenever we met, we considered it to be a historic occasion. You know, if we sold 400 books of poetry in Canada, we considered ourselves to be well on our way to immortality. But I think the first writer that touched me was maybe I was 15, and I came upon the work, to translate a work of Federico Garcia Lorca. I think the translations were... a team, half of which was Stephen Spender, the original book that I found. And I remember reading a line, I want to pass through the arches of Elvira to see her thighs and begin weeping. I think that line destroyed any possibility of my going into the clothing business. I thought that all women inhabited this highly charged landscape that poetry seemed to arise from. It seemed to be the natural language of women. And it seemed to me that if you wanted to address women, if you wanted to communicate with women, you had to do it with this highly charged language.
Is romance something you believe in?
Romance?
Mm.
I never knew what people meant when they say romance. I always thought of romance as the ideal smeared with possibility.
The Chelsea Hotel song was your tribute to a friend.
Mm-hmm. Well, I had met Janis Joplin in the Chelsea Hotel. That was in the mid-60s. We didn't know it was the 60s then. We just thought it was ordinary time. And I'd noticed her in the elevator. She really had that classic pop star's life where she would, you know, sing for 20,000 people and go home alone, and go home deeply lonely. It was a couple of years later, I was sitting at the bar of a Polynesian restaurant in Miami Beach, and the presence of this singer became very strong, and I started writing these lines. I remember you well at the Chelsea Hotel. You were famous, your heart was a legend. You told me again you preferred handsome men, but for me you'd make an exception. And clenching their fists for the ones like us who are oppressed like by the figures of beauty. You fixed yourself. You said, well, never mind. We're ugly, but we have the music.
You fixed yourself. You said, well, never mind. We are ugly, but we have the music.
I'm Your Man is his best album since Songs of Love and Hate. It's already been hailed as an album of the year.
I had to go back to the beginning. And try to determine really where I was in regard to my own song, and I realized that I'd have to find another kind of language that was much more, a much flatter kind of language, which I think this record has, a kind of surface, a simplicity, something limpid, very lucid, and very flat. And I began that lyric just kind of trying to locate myself. I stumbled out of bed. I got ready for the struggle. I smoked a cigarette. I tightened up my gut. I said, this can't be me. Must be my double. I can't forget. I can't forget. Can't forget, but I don't remember what. But that was really close to the bone. And that's where I'd like to keep my lyrics now.
They sentenced me to 20 years of boredom.
The lyric of First You Take Manhattan is something else because, you know, I've set it to a kind of Serge Leone, Clint Eastwood soundtrack, which, you know, throws the lyric into some doubt, throws it into some demented and somewhat humorous predicament, but not altogether.
It was a sort of image of you as a misery monger encouraging suicide. You know,
it's like the assumption is that the world is really very gay and jovial and nothing terrible ever happens. I think the songs are true and they're not for everybody. But I think that the effect they have on people whose nature can respond to them is far from depressing.
Have you ever got close to suicide?
Sometimes I've hoped it would end, but I think that my religious training is too deeply set for me to really think of ending my life. I met in the park behind my mother's house. I used to hang out there, and I saw a young man. He must have been 16 or 17. I must have been about 13 or 14. And he was a Spaniard, and he played flamenco guitar. And I had just bought a guitar, and I asked him to give me lessons. And he gave me three lessons on the guitar. And he taught me a tremolo, and he taught me a certain Spanish progression. He didn't turn up for the fourth lesson, and I called his boarding house, and I found that he'd committed suicide. I don't think this was directly connected to my progress as his student.
In Songs from a Room, it really seems as if Leonard Cohen's playing up to his bedsit audience. It's the epitome of bedsit culture. He's got some really good tracks on it. What many people don't realise is that he's been funny for a long time. Just take a listen to this one. Hey, listen to this one. Don't go away. Listen to this one. This is really good. Oh, come on, this one's got a real beat to it. Come on, this is Leonard Cohen being exciting and fun. Come and listen to this one. Come back. Come on back.